I'm Mike Donahue. Welcome to the conversation. Irvin Weathersby lectures in the English department here at Queensborough Community College. He teaches composition and creative writing. He's a former high school teacher and educator who has worked in Baltimore, the South Bronx, and Harlem. A lot of Irvin's writing centers on marginalized communities, and your essays, Irvin, I know have appeared in places like Esquire, The Root, EBONY, and elsewhere. Welcome. It's great to have you with us.
Thank you, Mike. Looking forward to the conversation.
Hey, we're going to talk about your upcoming book in Open Contempt, which is published by Viking Penguin shortly. It's a memoir about race and art in the South. But before we talk about that, because you've had such a rich journey as an educator, share with me a little bit about your career prior to Queensborough.
Sure. I began as a high school teacher in Baltimore, and I became a teacher right after I graduated college. So it was pretty actually a harrowing experience in the sense that I was 22 years old and I was teaching high school students who weren't much younger than I was. So it was definitely a challenging experience, but extremely rewarding in the sense that it taught me so much about myself. So I taught there in Baltimore in high school in a neighborhood called Cherry Hill, which is a pretty rough area and has been isolated from the city in a way by a waterway. And it was the population, my students were primarily students living in public housing, and the whole island of sorts is isolated like a peninsula. And the entire island really is a grouping of housing projects. And it was just incredibly challenging to kind of deal with some of the things that they were faced with and trying to kind of learn what it meant to be a teacher. So after 4 years, I eventually started teaching adult education in Baltimore and at a number of different colleges and adult education settings, libraries. And then fast forward, I decided that I wanted to pursue writing seriously. So I moved to New York to attend school at the New School. And in the process, I actually taught for a year here in New York City in Brooklyn. That was also a very challenging experience. But after that year, after I graduated, I found my way teaching justice-involved persons, specifically 18 and 24-year-olds in the South Bronx and Harlem in a reentry program. And a reentry program is basically a program designed by the city or state to allow justice-involved persons to seek some alternative to incarceration and or reenter society after being jailed or in prison. So I was tasked with, as an education coordinator, I was tasked with ensuring that students received a GED or a certificate or even a college diploma. And some of those students kind of did go on and earn some college credits. And so that was all of my history kind of before I came to QCC in 2009. And I originally started at QCC as an adjunct. And through a number of different kind of years and shifts and department chairs, I eventually earned tenure last semester in the English department.
Oh, congratulations on that.
Thank you.
You must have learned an awful lot about yourself while you were teaching in Baltimore. And those first couple of years as a teacher, as I have family who are in education, those are life-shaping years for teachers. Can you tell me a little bit about that experience?
Yeah, it was incredibly challenging. I have a toddler, but before he was born, I often would tell people that the hardest thing I've ever done was teach high school. And my first year of high school was the hardest thing. One, because it really upset all of my expectations of what you think a teacher is, right? Mm-hmm. Or what a teacher should do. And I realized that ultimately to be a really good teacher is something that you do all the time. So what I mean by that, if I'm watching television or reading a book, I started to realize that I had to do it effectively, at least for me, from my perspective. I had to always kind of think about well, how could I kind of further engage my students? How could I, what am I consuming that I could also share with my students? And another thing that really, that I learned in a way from teaching in my first couple of experiences is that I'm not the sole teacher in the room, right? It's a really interesting kind of Western idea that, you know, you stand in front of the class and you disseminate information and the students are supposed to regurgitate it. And I learned early on that that wasn't the case. So I learned so much about my students' lives, about their experiences, about their cultures. Although many times we shared culture, I think there was so much in terms of like specificity of Baltimore, specificity of their circumstances that weren't necessarily my own. So ultimately, I think the biggest lesson I learned was grace and patience and flexibility in terms of trying to kind of meet people where they are and figure out what their potential is and where they want to go. Because ultimately, my goal as an educator is to really try to help students kind of help themselves in a way. One of the mantras or the axioms that I live by and I tell my students is that, look, I'm just a coach. You guys are the players. The players got to play. I can draw, you know, the plays and give you all the tools, but that's it. You have to kind of go and grasp all of your life's potential.
Let's stay in Baltimore for a moment, because I want to talk about a piece that you wrote in The Atlantic that goes back, I guess, about 6 years now. It was about 25-year-old Freddie Gray Jr.'s death. Gray was arrested by three cops there in Baltimore. They were on bike patrol. Less than an hour later, he was unconscious and he wasn't breathing in the police station, and he died from complications due to a cervical spine injury. Now, video emerged, of course, and there were huge protests. Part of the city shut down. Schools closed. I remember pictures of students, young students, really young students, being confronted by huge cops in full riot gear. A lot of it is known now as the Baltimore Uprising, and some point to it as the start of the Black Lives Matters movement. For this piece, when you talked to a teacher there about the school closing and related events, she shared with you something, and I want to quote her. She said, "We have not prepared our students for the world." What did she mean by that? And do you feel that there's been, I don't know, any progress over this last couple of years about preparing children for the world?
Wow. When she told me that, I was really kind of floored in a way, because I do agree with her. And unfortunately, I think, you know, those sentiments still ring true. And if I can interpret what she meant, I think in a way what we're doing or what a lot of the public education systems and structures are doing is kind of creating robots in a way to kind of work in an outmoded kind of century in a way, right? When students could get a high school diploma and go into a factory and get these kind of practical skills to kind of work and buy a home and live the American dream, right? But that's not the case anymore. And I think what she was trying to say is that we're not really giving students enough information to kind of exist within the world and to kind of engage with all of its conflicts. But specifically, the conflict has that really undergirds all of American kind of interactions. And that is the problem with race. We're still dealing with this for centuries. And in a way, I truly think that what we can do is really try to kind of get outside of the classrooms and really move outside of these textbooks, many of which are outdated. And to give you like a quick anecdote, a couple quick anecdotes.
Yeah.
When I was in Baltimore teaching, one of the first things that really left me disheartened was the fact that my students didn't have books to take home. And so it's like, well, I don't get it. Like, how are you supposed to do homework if you don't have books at home? And I think that's the rub. Like the system is set up where it doesn't, like, we don't really care about what's happening outside of school. We are just here to kind of house you and kind of move you on into the next system that will continue to oppress you. Right. And so that really was just disheartening, and trying to figure out ways in which I could kind of supplement my students' education outside of these textbooks that are not really telling accurate history. And I'll give you another example from this semester. A student in my creative writing class, actually the first student to kind of submit his writing for to be workshop, wrote about the past summer and the events of the events that transpired after George Floyd's murder. And he wrote about really trying to understand how to protest. He was enraged, he was upset, but he didn't really know what to do. He wanted to do something. He wanted to go out and figure out how to be and to kind of create some change and be with his friends and create some change. And it was a really incredible essay of a student learning himself and learning the political process and learning how he could advocate for himself and people who look like him. And so I think that's what we kind of need to be teaching our students. And with the emergence of the 1619 Project, which seeks to kind of strip all of the lies from our history books and kind of teach students the history of America, specifically as it relates to the foundation of America, as it relates to American slavery and the transatlantic slave trade, and how all of these things have thrust America into its position as the largest economic and military force in the world, right? And I think these are the lessons that need to be taught. And these are the things that we're not teaching our students. We're teaching them things to kind of regurgitate and kind of move on, but we're not giving them critical skills to really change and shape the world around them.
But you mentioned the young man that you're working with there at Queensborough, who's really learning and has learned a lot over the years from his experience really on the street with the process and learning on the fly. And you finished your piece in The Atlantic saying that, you know, yes, there are lots of lessons available in school, but perhaps more valuable are the streets themselves, that they themselves serve as excellent teachers.
Yeah, I think it's incredibly powerful. Even the way his classmates responded to that, I truly agree with that statement. I still believe that's true. There's so much to kind of be gained, things that can't be quantified in terms of how that moment is going to stick with him for the rest of his life, right? And unfortunately, within the past 10 years or so, even 15 years, there have been many opportunities for students to kind of learn these tough lessons, whether it's Freddie Gray or Trayvon Martin or Michael Brown or a number of people, Breonna Taylor, where we continue to kind of recognize and understand that our lives are not seen as valuable. And so what do you do with that? Well, you have to kind of get out and engage with people and really tell them that and really assert your humanity and say, look, I am valuable. And in the process of asserting your humanity, you learn what that means. You learn like how to be more human, how to kind of demand a space in this society. And I think that's what the students learned. And I think that's what, in a way, we all need to learn. And, you know, it's not just about students and not just about young people, but we have to kind of start to engage with this persistent problem that continues to kind of bear its head.
Well, of course, your book has got a lot to do with this, your memoir. Your book features the streets and public art in the streets, especially in New Orleans, where you're from and where you grew up. So I want to walk with you through some of those streets and see what you see and smell what you smell and hear what you hear. So would you be able to, you know, kind of close your eyes and give me a guided tour down, you know, your favorite streets, the ones that are most meaningful to you?
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you for this exercise. Let me see if I can close my eyes and kind of do it. Let's see. So the street I'm seeing could be any of our major avenues. And what I'm seeing on this street are these incredible grand oak trees that have stood for centuries. And they are on both sides of our street. They're on the sidewalks. And they are leaning towards the center of our streets. And they're meeting over the median, as we call it, the space in New Orleans, this area that divides our street. We call them the neutral grounds. And I'm seeing these incredibly gnarled and wrangled branches kind of weaving and winding and finding their way in the middle of our streets and kind of touching on both sides. So on one side of the street, these branches are extending. On the other side, they're extending, and they're creating this incredible canopy that gives me goosebumps, right? So you ride through our streets and they're shaded by this incredible canopy of oak trees that has provided shade and warmth and beauty. And these are the streets where we parade, where we celebrate our loved ones, where we second line, where the streetcars kind of run. That's what I remember about home. And it still kind of gives me goosebumps in a way to kind of see those images that I don't think exist anywhere else in the world, where you have these century old trees that is just beautiful, just majestic, picturesque in a way.
That's given me a very good feeling for your book. But the streets, of course, can't be and aren't neutral, right? I mean, there is they speak to you, and there's art and there are monuments up there. So not only the trees, but the environment tells a story. And you've got a particular interest in a lot of that public art and those monuments that are in New Orleans. So share with me a little bit about the title of your book and In Open Contempt, and what you're looking to find and explore.
Yeah, so when I was an undergrad at Morehouse College, I had a history professor, actually the chair of the history department. As I was trying to transfer to Morehouse, I studied that at the University of New Orleans for a couple of years, and I transferred to Morehouse, and I was trying to transfer my history credits. And, you know, you have to meet with each chair for them to sign off. And in our meeting, the chair told me, hey, look, you know, I know you got an A in this history class, but this is not going to work here. And I was really upset. You know, I was like, hey, man, look, you know, I got an A. I worked hard for this class. And, you know, ultimately he told me that, son, you know, the history of the world didn't start in Europe. This class is the history of the Western civilization. And here at Morehouse, which is an HBCU, all Black institution, we begin where the world began, in Africa. And so you have to take this class again. And I was like, look, man, you know, I don't want to be in this class with freshmen and all these other things. But I say that to say that that is one of the really pivotal and seminal moments of my career, because in a way I had to kind of unlearn history and to learn it the way in which it should be told. And I say all that to say that, you know, that class taught me, yeah, about the ancient civilizations of Egypt and where humanity kind of arose from in terms of Africa. But all of my classes were like that. And specifically my African-American literature course, which was kind of like a senior seminar. And in this course, I was able to read the majority, if not all, of the slave narratives that were written. And the most important author of these slave narratives is Frederick Douglass. And my book, the title comes from his autobiography, at least one of his autobiographies. It comes from a scene where he is describing his cell, the first time he is sold off into slavery. Now, he was born into slavery, but as a young boy, he was able to kind of learn to read and write because he had a really sympathetic mistress.
Right.
And this mistress was able to kind of sneak him things to read and really allowed him to start to develop as a human being. But when his master died, when her husband died, ultimately, they had to divide up his inheritance, right? And so his inheritance included all of his property and his money, and his property included Frederick himself. And during this moment, when he first realized, like, wait a minute, you know, I am like an animal, like I am reduced, like a beast held in open contempt of my humanity. That was the experience that really resonated with me in terms of thinking about all of the art that we see littered all over the world. And my book specifically The impetus came from 2017, the spring of 2017, when then Mayor Mitch Landrieu decided that he wanted to remove four Confederate monuments from New Orleans. And I'm in Brooklyn, and you know, I'm away. I was planning my wedding at the time. And I wanted to be home. I wanted to feel the energy of the city changing to kind of be moved by something that I thought would never happen in my life. And that event was the idea that we need to kind of reconsider our times, to reconsider what we're honoring, reconsidering who these men were. And these men were devils. And, you know, they enslaved my ancestors, and the idea of the symbolism that they still represent still affects me today. And so I went home after my wedding, after my honeymoon in the summer of 2017, and I walked my city and I examined all of the monuments that the mayor decided to take down. And I examined all of the monuments that are still up. And in the process, I was really trying to engage with public space and really trying to engage with these spaces where these things were, right? Mm-hmm. Because New Orleans was such an important city in terms of the transatlantic slave trade, because it was the waterway, it was the highway of sorts that was able to transport all of these goods, including enslaved Africans, throughout North America, right? And so those are some of the ideas that I'm wrestling with in the book. I'm really trying to understand what these men represent, why some of them are still standing, and how we can kind of reimagine our times. How can we allow ourselves to not be burdened by this pernicious institution of racism and bigotry and white supremacy? So that's kind of what my book's about. And me walking through New Orleans, and looking at all these monuments, what I do as well as I'm ruminating and meditating on these spaces, I take you all over the world into museums and other places where I've done the same thing. So the book winds up in Cuba. I'm in Italy. I'm looking at Michelangelo's David, which is considered to be the perfect statue. I go to Paris, I'm in the Louvre, and I'm looking at all of these ideas, all of these portraits, all of these symbols of white supremacy, and I'm trying to figure out a way in which we can kind of change our circumstances to kind of reconsider the things that we're honoring.
I know you're a world traveler. You talk about poetry and passports, and in New Orleans, when you grew up, you said you were raised on po' boys and fried shrimp and hip hop. So I want to get a sense from you about what sticks with you now that you're in Brooklyn. What sticks with you from New Orleans, and who or what inspires you?
Really good question. So I didn't really understand the gift that I had or that has been bestowed on me to be born in New Orleans until I left New Orleans. Because New Orleans is like no other city in the world in terms of being rich in culture, of music and food and humanity, and really just importance to America, right? So, you know, just as a young boy, I think one of the things that really was formative in my experience was the explosion of hip hop. And hip hop was a way in which was the way in which I learned poetry, in a sense. While I'm an English professor and a writer, I didn't necessarily have books growing up in my household. You know, my parents weren't necessarily readers. They read the newspaper here or there, but we didn't have tons of books. But my grandmother did. And my grandmother was a woman who was very devout, very religious, and really often kind of fed me books. And some of my first books were the Bible, but also some of the other things that she was able to kind of give me was allowed me to kind of see myself as it relates to kind of being a Black person in America, in New Orleans. And New Orleans is really unique in a sense that every person I knew growing up played an instrument, right? And for some reason or another, when I left New Orleans, you get this kind of this notion that being in the band has this negative connotation, like you're a nerd. But to be in the band in New Orleans was actually cooler than actually being on the team or whatever.
These are marching bands, right?
Yeah, these marching bands, right? Because these the marching bands are the sounds of our parades, right? So all of these parades, the music and the soundtrack of our experience was created by us, by young people, and our bands are world renowned, and we practice and we study, and some of my fondest memories are kind of going to a park with our trumpets with me and my friends. And we're, you know, in elementary school and we're just trying to play the scales. We're trying to kind of, you know, we're trying to be all of our heroes. We're trying to kind of play this brass music. We want to celebrate our city and ourselves. And that was the beginning of my relationship with music. But as I move into hip hop, I was able to understand and see myself reflected again. While hip hop is dominated by men, there are a number of different kind of perspectives. And particularly in New Orleans, we actually have a number of trans musicians. So that was some of my first expressions to sexuality. But I say all that to say is that the music and the sound of poetry was infused in my experience of just kind of embracing hip hop and embracing my community in New Orleans.
I know you're still writing your book. It's probably another 18 months or so before it's out. But can you share with me any, without giving away too much, a scenario or two from the book where you open up about your personal experiences?
Yeah. So some of the book is written, some of it is not, and much of it, you know, I'm still kind of working on. But one of the passages that I'm most proud of is the experience of describing the first time I've been arrested. And I was actually arrested a few weeks before my 35th birthday. And this happened here in Williamsburg, Brooklyn. And the way in which I describe it really was, I guess, triggered by driving past the ruins of Robert E. Lee's monument in New Orleans. And when I was in New Orleans in the summer of 2017, as I'm kind of touring the city and just trying to get a sense of all of these monuments that are up and the ones that were removed, early one morning, I'm driving past Lee Circle, where his former monument stood, and there was a city worker painting over some graffiti, and the graffiti was "Justice for Philando," and Philando refers to Philando Castile. And the day before that I saw this kind of graffiti and this person kind of painting over it, the police officer who murdered Philando Castile was acquitted, right? He was acquitted on all charges. And, you know, I was incredibly upset and saddened. And whomever, you know, spray painted those words also kind of expressed my sentiments as well. And so in that moment, I was triggered to kind of remember my own experience with being arrested. And it was very similar to his in that my partner was there with me and it was the middle of the night and I feared for my life. Right. And, you know, just to kind of detail the experience a little bit, I was just driving home after eating a meal in Williamsburg with my wife, and a police officer kind of turned after me and pulls me over and says that he pulled me over because my tent's too dark. And I was like, hey, look, all right, I'm not going to argue with this guy. This is kind of ridiculous. It's nighttime. I'm not sure how he could tell that my tent was too dark, but okay, fine. You know, I've been through the charade before. Here's my name. Here's my license, officer. I'm not a criminal. Run my name. But what happened, you know, after he ran my name, there was an outstanding warrant for a bike ticket. And I received a bike ticket a couple years earlier for riding my bike on the sidewalk. And look, I was guilty of that offense, but the offense was me riding past a bodega on the corner of my home to my front door. I had written on the street the whole time. And as I'm exiting the street so I can kind of go to my house, I may have written on the sidewalk for 15 minutes or so. I mean, I'm sorry, for 10 feet or so. And these cops, you know, jump out of their car and they're like, you know, hey, let me see your license and your name. And I didn't know what was going on. I was like, hey, look, you know, what's going on? And ultimately, they gave me a ticket. And that citation, I fought. I went to the city. I said, look, this is ridiculous. I know it's $25, but I'm not going to be entered into this system. I'm not going to enter into this exchange for $25. I don't believe I did anything wrong. So ultimately, this police officer arrests me. I try to get out of it by giving him my CUNY ID to say I'm a professor. Many times before, that has worked because, you know, police officers have often recognized our shared source of income and sometimes like, hey, look, just have a nice day. But this guy wanted to give me a hard time. And so he arrested me. And in the process of arresting me, we have this incredible exchange where he tells me that, look, just because you're a professor, you know, you think I'm supposed to give you special treatment. And that injured me so severely because that's not what I wanted. I just wanted equal treatment. I just wanted to kind of be free to kind of go and live my life and not be, you have to spend a night in jail because of what, you know, because of some ridiculous rule. And even when I was there, this was so bizarre. Even when I was there waiting to kind of be seen by a judge and kind of meeting all of the people who were also thrust into my cell, the attending officer told me that, look, we don't even issue citations for this anymore. Like this, the city has decided that this is a ridiculous citation. So I'm sitting in the jail cell for something that is not even enforced anymore. And it just really kind of speaks to the experience, the Black experience that I'm trying to create in my book. I'm trying to not just think about my own life. I'm trying to figure out, well, how is this representative of all of our lives, right? And that's just kind of one scene that I'm most proud of, but also kind of speaks to my position at QCC. I was still a professor at QCC, and I actually missed the next day of school because, you know, I didn't get released until noon.
Well, lessons from the street, right?
To say the least, you know.
How about some next projects? What are you working on after the book comes out? Because I'm sure you've got a few things rattling around.
I'm always thinking about something, right? I'm actually working on an essay about the pandemic and some of the hard lessons that my wife and I had to kind of deal with. My wife is a healthcare worker. I'm obviously an essential worker, and having to kind of figure out childcare for our son. So I'm working on something that who knows what that kind of becomes. And I'm also kind of working on something that's related to the book, but it may kind of be something else. As I mentioned earlier, as being a former educator and a reentry program, I'm working on trying to kind of figure out where are my students now? Right? Where are my former students now? What happened, you know, when I was there kind of trying to help them gain some sort of education? And where are they now? The things that we try to provide for them, did they help them? And if not, what do they still need now, right? And trying to think about the crisis of mass incarceration and figuring out, like, how can I kind of be of service to that? But, you know, those are just some ideas that I'm kind of working on. There's always something going on. I'm always reading something exciting. And ultimately, reading often kind of triggers my ideas. So I'm looking forward to kind of finishing this book and all of the potential that could come from it. And one of the things we'll see, hopefully it's received well, but maybe to kind of do this again. You know, a lot of people, when I tell them about my book, it's like, oh, well, have you gone here? Have you gone there? Like, no, actually, I haven't. But, you know, this book is not an encyclopedia. It's not something that I've written in volumes, but maybe I could be like Frederick Douglass and write multiple versions of this, right? And continue to kind of see where this is happening in other places of the world where I haven't been. So those are some of the ideas that, you know, potentially I could pursue.
Well, we look forward to the book coming out. We'll look for your byline. And I really appreciate the time and the conversation that we've had this morning. Thank you.
Thank you, Mike.